Chapter 12 Sound. Every day we hear sounds from various sources like humans, birds, bells, machines, vehicles, televisions, radios, etc. Sound is a form of energy which produces a sensation of hearing in our ears. There are also other forms of energy like mechanical energy, light energy, etc. We have talked about mechanical energy in the previous chapters. You have been taught about conservation of energy, which states that we can neither create nor destroy energy. We can just change it from one form to another. When you clap, a sound is produced. Can you produce sound without utilizing your energy? Which form of energy did you use to produce sound? In this chapter, we are going to learn how sound is produced and how it is transmitted through a medium and received by our ear. Production of sound. Activity 12.1. Taking a tuning fork and set it vibrating by striking its prong on a rubber pad, bring it near your ear. Do you hear any sound? Touch one of the prongs of the vibrating tuning fork with your finger and share your experience with your friends. Now, suspend a table tennis ball or a small plastic ball by a thread from a support. Take a big needle and a thread, put a knot at one end of the thread, and then with the help of the needle, pass the thread through the ball. Touch the ball gently with the prong of a vibrating tuning fork. Observe what happens and discuss with your friends. Activity 12.2. Fill water in a beaker or a glass up to the brim. Gently touch the water surface with one of the prongs of the vibrating tuning fork as shown in the figure 12.2. Next, dip the prong of the vibrating tuning fork in water as shown in the figure 12.3. Observe what happens in both the cases. Discuss with your friends why this happens. From the above activities, what do you conclude? Can you produce sound without a vibrating object? In the above activities, we have produced sound by striking the tuning fork. We can also produce sound by plucking, scratching, rubbing, blowing, or shaking different objects. As per the above activities, what do we do to the objects? We set the objects vibrating. And produce sound. Vibration means a kind of rapid to and fro motion of an object. The sound of the human voice is produced due to vibrations in the vocal cords. When a bird flaps its wings, do you hear any sound? Think how the buzzing sound accompanying a bee is produced. Stretch rubber band when plucked vibrates and produces sound. If you have never done this, then do it and observe the vibration of the stretched rubber band. Propagation of sound. Sound is produced by vibrating objects. The matter or substance through which sound is transmitted is called a medium. It can be solid, liquid, or gas. Sound moves through a medium from the point of generation to the listener. When an object vibrates, it sets the particles of the medium around it vibrating. The particles do not travel all the way from the vibrating object to the ear. A particle of the medium in contact with the vibrating object is first displaced from its equilibrium position. It then exerts a force on the adjacent particle, as a result of which the adjacent particle gets displaced from its position of rest. After displacing the adjacent particles, the first particle comes back to its original position. This process continues in the medium till the sound reaches your ear. The disturbance created by a source of sound in the medium travels through the medium and not the particles of the medium. A wave is a disturbance that moves through a medium when the particles of the medium set neighboring particle into motion. They in turn produce similar motions in others. The particles of the medium do not move forward themselves, but the disturbance is carried forward. This is what happens during propagation of sound in a medium. Hence, sound can be visualized as a wave. Sound waves are characterized by the motion of particles in the medium and are called mechanical waves. Air is the most common medium through which sound travels. When a vibrating object moves forward, it pushes and compresses the air in front of it, creating a region of high pressure. This region is called a compression. See, as shown in the figure 12.5, this compression starts to move away from the vibrating object. When the vibrating object moves backward, it creates a region of lower pressure called refraction R, as shown in the figure 12.5. As the object moves back and forth rapidly, a series of compressions and refractions is created in the air. These make the sound wave that propagates through the medium. Compression is the reason of high pressure and refraction is the reason of low pressure. Pressure is related to the number of particles of a medium in a given value. More density of the particles in the medium gives more pressure and vice versa. The propagation of a sound can be visualized as propagation of density vibrations, variations or pressure variations in the medium. Sound needs a medium to travel. Sound is a mechanical wave and needs a material medium like air, water, steel, etc. for its propagation. It cannot travel through vacuum, which can be demonstrated by the following experiment. Take an electric bell and an airtight glass bell jar. The electric bell is suspended inside the airtight bell jar. The bell jar is connected to a vacuum pump, as shown in the figure 12.6. If you press the switch, you will be able to hear the bell. Now start the vacuum pump. When the air in the jar is pumped out gradually, the sound becomes fainter, although the same current is passing through the bell. After some time, when less air is left inside the bell jar, you will hear a very feeble sound. What will happen if the air is removed completely? Will you still be able to hear sound of the bell? Sound waves are longitudinal waves. Activity 12.4. Take a slinky. Ask your friend to hold one end. You hold the other end. Now stretch the slinky as shown in the figure 12.7a. Then give it a sharp push towards your friend. What do you notice? If you move your hand pushing and pulling the slinky alternatively, what will you observe? If you mark a dot on the slinky, you will observe that dot on the slinky will move back and forth parallel to direction of the propagation of the disturbance. The regions where the coils become closer are called compressions and the regions where the coils are further apart are called refractions. As we already know, sound propagates in the medium as a series of compressions and refractions. Now we can compare the propagation of disturbance in the slinky with the sound propagation in the medium. These waves are called longitudinal waves. In these waves, the individual particles of the medium move in a direction parallel to the direction of propagation of the disturbance. The particles do not move from one place to another, but they simply oscillate back and forth about their position of the rest. This is exactly how a sound wave propagates. Hence, sound waves are longitudinal waves. There is also another type of wave called a transverse wave. In a transverse wave, particles do not oscillate along the direction of a wave propagation but oscillate up and down about their mean position as the wave travels. Thus, a transverse wave is the one in which the individual particles of the medium move about their mean position in a direction perpendicular to the direction of the wave propagation. When we drop a pebble in a pond, the waves you see on the water surface is an example of transverse wave. Light is a transverse wave, but for light, the oscillations are not of the medium particles or their pressure or density. It is not a mechanical wave. You will come to know more about transverse waves in higher classes. Characteristics of a sound wave. We can describe a sound wave by its frequency, amplitude, and speed. A sound wave in a graphic form is shown in figure 12.8c, which represents how density and pressure change when the sound wave moves in the medium. The density as well as the pressure of the medium at a given time varies with distance above and below the average value of density and pressure. Figure 12.8a and figure 12.8b represent the density and pressure variations respectively as a sound wave propagates in the medium. Compressions are the regions where particles are crowded together and represented by the upper portion of the curve in figure 12.8c. The peak represents the region of maximum compression, thus the compressions are regions where density as well as pressure is high. Refractions are the regions of low pressure where particles are spread apart and are represented by the valley that is the lower portion of the curve in figure 12.8c. A peak is called the crest and a valley is called the trough of a wave. The distance between the two consecutive compressions or two consecutive refractions is called as a wavelength, as shown in the figure 12.8c. The wavelength is usually represented by lambda, Greek letter lambda. Its SI unit is meter. Photoelectric effect, which was later explained by Albert Einstein, the SI unit of frequency was named as Hertz in his honor. Frequency tells us how frequently an event occurs. Suppose you are beating a drum. How many times you are beating the drum per unit time is called the frequency of your beating the drum. We know that when sound is propagated through a medium, the density of the medium oscillates between a maximum value or a minimum value. The change in density from the maximum value to the minimum value, then again to the maximum value, makes one complete oscillation. The number of such oscillations per unit time is frequency of the sound wave. If we can count the number of the compressions or refractions that cross us per unit time, we will get the frequency of the sound wave. It is usually represented by nu, Greek letter nu. Its SI unit is Hertz, symbol Hz. The time taken by the two consecutive compressions or refractions to cross a fixed point is called time period of a wave. In other words, we can say that the time taken for one complete oscillation is called the time period of the sound wave. It is represented by the symbol capital T. Its SI unit is second. Frequency and time period are related as follows. Nu is equal to 1 by T. A violin and a flute may both be played at the same time in an orchestra. Both sounds travel the same medium, travel through the same medium, that is air, and arrive at our ear at the same time. Both sounds travel at the same speed irrespective of the source, but the sounds we receive are different. This is due to the different characteristics associated with the sound. Pitch is one of the characteristics. How the brain interprets the frequency of an emitted sound is called its pitch. The faster the vibration of the source, the higher is the frequency and higher is the pitch, as shown in the figure 12.9. Thus, a high pitch sound corresponds to more number of compressions and refractions passing a fixed point per unit time. Objects of different sizes and conditions vibrate at different frequencies to produce sounds of different pitch. The magnitude of the maximum disturbance in the medium on either side of the mean value is called amplitude of the wave. It is usually represented by the letter A, as shown in the figure 12.8c. For sound, its unit will be that of density or pressure. The loudness or softness of sound is determined basically by its amplitude. The amplitude of the sound wave depends upon the force with which an object is made to vibrate. If we strike a table lightly, we hear a soft sound because we produce a sound wave of less energy, that is amplitude. If we hit the table hard, we hear the loud sound. Can you tell why? The sound wave spreads out from its source. As it moves away from the source, its amplitude as well as its loudness decreases. Louder sound can travel a longer distance as it associated with the higher energy. Figure 12.10 shows the wave shapes of a loud and a soft sound of the same frequency. The quality or timbre of sound is that characteristics which enables us to distinguish one sound from another having the same pitch and loudness. The sound which is more pleasant is said to be a rich quality. A sound of single frequency is called a tone. The sound which is produced due to a mixture of several frequencies is called a note and is pleasant to listen to. Noise is an unpleasant to the ear. Music is pleasant to hear and is rich of quality. The speed of sound is defined as the distance which a point on a wave, such as a compression or a refraction, travels per time. We know that speed is equal to v is equal to distance by time, so is equal to lambda by t. Here lambda is the wavelength of the sound wave. It is the distance traveled by the sound wave in one time period of the wave. Thus v is equal to lambda nu, because 1 by t is equal to nu. So v is equal to lambda into nu, that is speed is equal to wavelength into frequency. The speed of the sound remains almost the small same for all frequencies in a given medium under the same physical conditions. The time taken by the wave to travel a distance d is given by the formula t is equal to d by v. The amount of sound energy passing each second through unit area is called the intensity of the sound. We sometimes use the terms loudness and intensity interchangeably, but they are not the same. Loudness is a measure of response of the ear to the sound. Even
When two sounds are of equal intensity, we may hear one as louder than the other simply because our ear detects it better. Speed of sound in different media. Sound propagates through a medium at the finite speed. The sound of a thunder is heard a little later than the flash of light is seen.
So we can make out that sound travels with a speed which is much less than the speed of light. The speed of sound depends on the properties of the medium through which it travels. You will learn about this dependence in higher classes.
The speed of sound in a medium depends on temperature of the medium. The speed of sound decreases when we go from solid to gaseous state. In any medium, as we increase the temperature, the speed of the sound increases. For example, the speed of sound in air is 331 meter per second at 0 degrees Celsius and 334 meter per second at 22 degrees Celsius. The speed of the sound at the particular temperature in various media are listed in table 12.1. You need not to memorize the values.
Reflection of sound. Sound bounces off a solid or a liquid like a rubber ball bounces off a wall like light. Sound gets reflected at the surface of a solid or liquid and follows the same laws of reflection as have studied in earlier classes. The direction in which the sound is incident and is reflected make equal angle with the normal to the reflecting surface at the point of incidence, and the three are in the same plane. An obstacle of the large size, which may be polished or rough, is needed for the reflection of sound waves. Echo. If we shout or clap near a suitable reflecting object such as tall building or a mountain, we will hear the same sound again little later. This sound which we hear is called an echo. The sensation of sound persists in our brain about 0.1 seconds. To hear a distinct echo, the time interval between the original sound and the reflected one must be at least 0.1 seconds. If we take the speed of sound to be 344 meter per second at a given temperature, say at 22 degrees Celsius in air, the sound must go to the obstacles and reach back to ear of the listener on the reflection after 0.1 seconds. Hence, the total distance covered by the sound from the point of generation to the reflecting surface and back would be at least 344 meter per second into 0.1 seconds is equal to 34.4 meter. Thus, for hearing distinct echoes, the minimum distance of the obstacle from the source of the sound must be half of this distance, that is 7.2 meter. This distance will change with the temperature of air. Echoes may be heard more than once due to successive or multiple reflections. The rolling of the thunder is due to the successive reflections of the sound from a number of reflecting surfaces such as clouds and the land. Reverberation. A sound created in a big hall will persist by repeated reflection from the walls until it is reduced to a value where it is no longer audible. The repeated reflection that results in the persistence of sound is called reverberation. In an auditorium or a big hall, excessive reverberation is highly undesirable. To reduce reverberation, the roof and walls of auditorium are generally covered with the sound absorbent material like compressed fiberboard, rough plaster or draperies. The seat material are also selected on the basis of their sound absorbing properties. Uses of multiple reflection of sound. Megaphones or loudhailers, horns, musical instruments such as trumpets and shehnais are all designed to send sound in a particular direction without spreading it in all directions as shown in figure 12.12. In these instruments, a tube followed by a conical opening deflects sound successively to guide most of the sound waves from the source in the forward direction towards the audience. Stethoscope is a medical instrument used for listening to sounds produced within the body, chiefly in the heart or lungs. In stethoscope, the sound of the patient's heartbeat reaches the doctor's ears by multiple reflection of sound as shown in figure 12.13. Generally, ceiling of concert halls, conference halls and cinema halls are covered so that sound after reflection reaches all corners of the hall as shown in the figure 12.14. Sometimes a curved sound board may be placed behind the stage so that the sound after reflecting from the sound board spreads evenly across the width of the hall. Range of hearing. The audible range of sound for human beings extends from about 20 Hz to 20,000 Hz.
1 hertz is equal to 1 cycle per second. Children under the age of 5 and some animals such as dogs can hear up to 25 kilohertz. 1 kilohertz is equal to 1000 hertz. As people grow older, their ears become less sensitive to higher frequencies. Sounds of frequencies below 20 hertz are called infrasonic sound or infrasound. If we could hear infrasound, we would hear the vibrations of a pendulum just as we hear the vibrations of the wings of a bee. Rhinoceros communicate using infrasound or frequency as low as 5 hertz. Whales and elephants produce sound in the infrasound range. It is observed that some animals get disturbed before earthquakes. Earthquakes produce low frequency infrasound before the main shock waves begin, which possibly alert the animals. Frequency higher than 20 kilohertz are called ultrasonic sound or ultrasound. Ultrasound is produced by animals such as dolphins, bats, and porpoises. Moths of certain families have very sensitive hearing equipment. These moths can hear the high frequency squeaks of the bat and know when a bat is lying nearby and are able to escape capture. Rats are also play games by producing ultrasound. Applications of ultrasound. Ultrasounds are high frequency waves. Ultrasounds are able to travel along well-defined paths even in presence of obstacles. Ultrasounds are used extensively in industries and for medical purposes. Ultrasound is generally used to clean ports located in hard to reach places. For example, spiral tube, odd shaped parts, electronic components, etc. Objects to be cleaned are placed in a cleaning solution and ultrasonic waves are sent into the solution. Due to high frequency, the particles of dust, grease and dirt get detached and drop out. The objects thus get thoroughly clean. Ultrasounds can be used to detect cracks and flaws in metal blocks. Metallic components are generally used in construction of big structures like buildings, bridges, machines and also scientific equipments. The cracks of or holes inside the metal blocks which are invisible from outside reduces the strength of the structure. Ultrasonic waves are allowed to pass through the metal block and detector are used to detect the transmitted waves. If there is even a small detect, the ultrasound gets reflected back, indicating the presence of the flaw or defect as shown in the figure 12.16. Ordinary sound of longer wavelengths cannot be used for such purpose as it is bent around the corners of the defective location and enter the detector. Ultrasonic waves are made to reflect from various parts of the heart and from the image of the heart. This technique is called as echocardiography. Ultrasound scanner is an instrument which uses ultrasonic waves for getting images of internal organs of the human body. A doctor may image the patient's organs such as liver, gallbladder, uterus, kidney, etc. It helps the doctor to detect abnormalities such as stones in the gallbladder and kidney or tumors in different organs. In this technique, the ultrasonic waves travel through the tissues of the body and get reflected from the region where there is a change of tissue density. These waves are then converted into electrical signals that are used to generate images of the organ. These images are then displayed on the monitor or printed on a film. This technique is called ultrasonography. Ultrasonography is also used for examination of the fetus during pregnancy to detect the congenital defects and growth abnormalities. Ultrasound may be employed to break small stones formed in the kidneys into fine grains. These grains later get flushed out with urine. Sonar. The acronym SONAR stands for Sound Navigation and Ranging. Sonar is a device that uses ultrasonic waves to measure the distance, direction and speed of underwater objects. How does the sonar work? Sonar consists of a transmitter and a detector and is installed in a boat or a ship as shown in figure. The transmitter produces and transmits ultrasonic waves. These waves travel through the water and after striking the object on the seabed, get reflected back and are sensed by the detector. The detector converts the ultrasonic waves into electrical signals which are appropriately interpreted. The distance of the object that reflected the sound wave can be calculated by knowing the speed of sound in water and time interval between the transmission and reception of this ultrasound. Let the time interval between transmission and the reception of ultrasound signal be T and the speed of the sound through seawater be V. The total distance 2D travelled by the ultrasound is then 2D is equal to V into T. The above method is called echo ranging. The sonar technique is used to determine the depth of the sea and to locate underwater hills, valleys, submarines, icebergs, sunken ships, etc. As mentioned earlier, bats search out prey and fly in the dark night by emitting and detecting the reflections of ultrasonic waves. The high-pitched ultrasonic squeaks of the bat are reflected from the obstacles of prey and return to bat ear. As shown in the figure 12.18, the nature of the reflections tells the bat where the obstacle or prey is and what it is like. Porpoises also use ultrasound for navigation and location of food in the dark. Structure of the human ear. How do we hear? We are able to hear with the help of an extremely sensitive device called the ear. It allows us to convert pressure via variations in air with audible frequencies into electrical signals that travel to the brain via the auditory nerve. The auditory aspect of human ear is discussed below. The outer ear is called pinna. It collects the sound from the surroundings. The collected sound passes through the auditory canal. At the end of the auditory canal, there is a thin membrane called the eardrum or tympanic membrane. When a compression of the medium reaches the eardrum, the pressure on the outside of the membrane increases and forces the eardrum inward. Similarly, the eardrum moves outward when a rarefaction reaches it. In this way, the eardrum vibrates. The vibrations are amplified several times by three bones, the hammer, anvil, and stirrup. In the middle ear transmits the amplified pressure variations received from the sound wave to the inner ear. In the inner ear, the pressure variations are turned into electrical signals by the cochlea. These electrical signals are sent to the brain via the auditory nerve, and the brain interprets them as sound. Thank you.